Well, with an introduction like that, it can only go downhill. Thank you, Sam. This gentleman spent most of this year, I'm sure, preparing for this meeting. I think we owe him a little round of applause for his diligence and for his hospitality. Thank you, sir. I'm greatly honored to kick off this meeting. It's a beautiful environment, a luxurious room, excellent facility to hold this meeting, and I'm very impressed with the beautiful city of Grand Rapids, which has been extraordinarily hospitable to me my brief stay here. As you can see on the screen, I'm going to talk about the emergence of predictive computational science. And the talk is divided into five little units. First and probably most important is the background. Why would you talk about this subject? And I'll talk about a canonical problem in predictive science, which is all the complications that one would like to avoid in making scientific predictions. And then I'll make an argument that the Bayesian framework is the proper framework to think of these problems. And I'll talk about a new algorithm. This has really just been published that attempts to capture all of the issues of predictability, error, selection of models, and so forth. And finally, in the last minute or so, I'll go over some general mathematical issues connected with modeling complex systems and using Bayesian methods for infinite and misspecified systems, infinite dimensional systems. So first, the background. Why would anyone use the word predictive science? Isn't all science predictive? Isn't that why we do science, to make predictions? So what's this? Why is this a new concept? Why is it now just emerging, when science has been around for 2,000 years? The logic of predictive science, what is predictive science and what is logic? Predictive science, I define it as the scientific discipline concerned with assessing the predictability of mathematical and computational models of physical events in the presence of uncertainties. That's critical. It embraces the processes of model selection. Oh, give you the wireless mic. Can you hear me?
They'll be able to hear you better now.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, then do you have an insert?
Yeah, put it right in. Can you get it in there?
Sorry. There we go. That'll work.
Great, thank you. Yeah. That better?
It embraces the processes of model selection, calibration, validation, verification, and their use in forecasting features of physical events with quantified uncertainty. What is a model? I'm not talking about a model airplane or a mouse model in biology or medicine. I'm talking about mathematical constructions based on physical principles or empirical relationships, generally based on inductive theories, which attempt to characterize abstractions of physical reality. So we all use models of various kinds. What do I mean by the word calibration? Well, all models have parameters. You take a model and you run experiments and you tune the parameters to agree with experiments. That's calibration. And what do I mean by validation? Well, the concept of validation is actually a very, very abstract concept. This is a cheap definition. Validation is just the process of determining the accuracy with which a model can predict reality, can predict observations. And I'm not going to talk much about verification. Remember, validation is, do I have the right equations? And verification is, did I solve the equations right? So verification generally has to do with the mathematical issue of whether I'm solving the correct equations that characterize the model. And finally, features of physical events. Those are the so-called QOIs, the quantities of interest. Someone finally realized if you want to determine if a model is valid, a model is not valid for everything. A model is valid for a very specific purpose. Those are the quantities of interest. So if you hear someone saying, I've developed a model to study the dynamical features of a system, then you know this person doesn't know anything about modeling. Because a model is designed not to observe global features of a system, but specific features of a system. That's a very frustrating and disappointing fact. But a model may be good for one thing and not good for anything else. And finally, quantified uncertainty. I'm going to make an argument right now that there's tremendous uncertainty in computational science. How do you quantify that uncertainty? And why is this now coming to the forefront? Well, I claim that what has happened over the last couple of decades is that the power of computing and the sophistication of models has brought us to a threshold where society is expecting quantitative solutions to important physical problems. And when we reach that threshold, we've discovered that most of our favorite models of the past are inadequate. No better example can be put forth than the nuclear test ban. We spent billions, billions of dollars on software to do simulations to displace experiments on the nuclear arsenal, only to find out that they're wrong. They don't predict very accurately. If you use data out of a handbook for parameters of a model and make a prediction, how often do you really think the predictions are correct? And of course, raise your hand if you think we can predict the climate. I don't see any hands. We cannot accurately predict climate change. And finally, what if you were told, we're going to do surgery on you on the basis of predictions? How many of you would go under the knife thinking that those predictions were accurate? So fear not, we're still in business, but we need to go back to the basic anatomy of a prediction. Science is the activity concerned with a systematic acquisition of knowledge. What is knowledge? Knowledge is the absence of ignorance. It's an enhancement of cognition to understand and appreciate the events that surround you. What are the pillars of science? The pillars of science have been argued for over 2,000 years. Basically, there were two in the 17th century. Now a third one is emerging. The pillars of science are observation. What does observation mean? It means to acquire knowledge through observing with your senses. You smell, you see, you hear, you touch, your taste, enhanced by instruments. So you get instruments to enhance your ability to make observations. And then theory, what is theory? Theory are inductive hypotheses put forth to explain events. And once explained, extrapolated into the future or extrapolated into the past. And finally, computer simulation, modeling and simulation, how can that be used to acquire knowledge? Your first impulse when you hear that, when you say that modeling and simulation can acquire knowledge, is, are you sure the models are any good? Are you sure the answers are any good? Because to claim simulation acquires knowledge must carry with it some expectation of the accuracy and the reliability of the model. Now, all this goes back to the basic foundations of logic.
Socrates says, you can't learn anything. Either the gods give you knowledge or you don't have it. Fortunately, Aristotle didn't believe that. Aristotle said, oh, no. Logic is required by demonstration and reasoning. And basically hit it right. Observation and theory. So Aristotle was a development of Aristotelian logic, deductive logic, the process of reasoning from one or more statements or axioms to reach logically certain conclusions. The foundations of mathematics is deductive logic. Deductive logic, by the way, mathematics, you will be surprised to hear, and you already know, is not science. I'll repeat that. Mathematics is not science. Mathematics is deduction, deductive logic. You state an axiom, and through the rules of logic, you determine its consequences. Deductive logic is infallible. If you reach a conclusion through deductive logic, it lasts forever. Inductive logic, on the other hand, the bottom-up logic, is the process of reasoning by generalizing or extrapolating from initial information, informational, it should be, hypotheses. Now, there is some scientific, science is inductive logic. Science, you put forth a hypothesis and you make decisions on the basis of the hypothesis until you find a contradiction and then you change it. So inductive logic can be wrong. Now, there is something called mathematical sciences, and that's okay. Mathematical sciences is where you have induction, you create a hypothesis, and on the basis of the hypothesis, you deduce its consequences. So it's a slight little difference between deduction and induction followed by deduction, which is the mathematical sciences. By the way, the famous philosopher of the 20th century, Karl Popper, really saved science from the point of view of philosophy. Because up to that time, the only way, the skeptics in philosophy said the only way you can really learn is through touching or feeling or seeing observations. And all this theory was not useful. Thank goodness people like Paul Dirac and Albert Einstein and Niels Bohr ignored that and went ahead and produced the foundations of modern science. And what Popper said is that a hypothesis will qualify as a scientific theory only if it can be falsified. So if you put forth a hypothesis and you want it to be written down as a scientific theory, it must be something that can later be proved or disproved by observation. So where do we stand? Well, we want to make a prediction. And to make a prediction, we have to have knowledge. And we have want knowledge about the physical universe. So there's knowledge. Way over there is reality. And the only way we can approach reality is through observations. And they're wrong, because there's always observational error. Or theory, models, and they're wrong, because no model is perfect. All models are wrong. And finally, if we want to compute, we discretize the models, and that furnishes information for knowledge. So we corrupt the model. The business of determining the corruption of a model is verification. The business of determining the accuracy of a model is called validation. So in the presence of uncertainty, what do we do? My first impulse is to say, oh, we'll use probability theory. We determine if an event is probable. We determine the uncertainty content in an observation, and we characterize it by a probability distribution. That's not the only way, by the way. There are other ways to do it, but by the first and most acceptable way.
is to use some measure of probability theory to shed light on observations, theory, and models. But what probability theory? How can the logic of the scientific method be extended to include uncertainties? Believe it or not, this was, to this day, being debated, but this was an issue particularly under study in the middle of the 20th century. And it more or less was resolved in a theorem due to R.T. Cox, Cox's theorem. In a nutshell, Cox's theorem says this: every extension of Aristotelian logic with uncertainties is Bayesian. Let me describe what that means. Completely counter to Komarov's probability theory, Cox laid down a logic of propositions using Boolean algebra. He said, I want to assign to a proposition a real number, call its plausibility, to obey a set of logical rules. So you take your so-called truth tables of logic, and instead of applying to simple statements, they apply to propositions. And he said more precisely, given a set of three desiderata, the desiderata, by the way, were fairly simple things. I want the measure of plausibility to be a number, a real number. I want to use common sense. Common sense means I will not violate the rules of deductive logic of Boolean sets. And consistency simply meaning that if two approaches lead to the same plausibility, there is a unique plausibility that can exist. Under those assumptions, he proved that the plausibility of a postulate conditioned on prior information is zero if it's false, it's one if it's true. It's scaled between zero and one, and most importantly, the conjunction of two plausibilities, in other words, A is a postulate, B is a postulate, if they're both true, conditioned on X, then this is so-called product rule of plausibilities. It's the conditional plausibility of A given X times the plausibility of B given that both A and X are true. Of course, when this scale plausibility is probability, and that last product rule is Bayes' theorem. This is quite startling. It means we came up with a conditional probability. We lay down a set of tight rules that it must obey, and we came up with a theorem that's been around since 1763. Bayes was a Presbyterian preacher. His father was a preacher. He discovered, Bayes' rule was known a long time. It was known by the Bernoullis, but Bayes was a member of the Royal Society. He was a good mathematician, very modest. He rarely put his name on a paper, usually anonymous. But he had enough published work that he became a member of the Royal Society. And he came across Bayes' theorem, and he wrote this essay on it. An essay towards solving a problem in the doctrine of chances, Proceedings of the Royal Society. He never published it. It sat on his desk for 20 years, and he died. And the executor of his estate, a guy named Richard Price, grabbed the manuscript and published it. I have a theory. I have no information that this is true or false, but I have a theory that Bayes was afraid to publish it, because Bayes' theorem determines cause and effect. You start with prior knowledge, you have a hypothesis, and on the basis of that knowledge, you gain knowledge. So could it be in Bayes' theorem is the existence or non-existence of God?
I have a hunch since old Mrs. Bayes was a preacher, he might have been worried about that. But anyway, he didn't publish it. And it sat there more or less dormant. Price visited Laplace about 12 years later. Laplace was also doing probability theory, more or less what we call the frequentist theory, where there's a single value of a parameter and the probability of an event is determined by the frequency of the event. But there are many events that don't have a frequency. How do you determine the probability of an event if it's never happened before? Or you have only one piece of data and the data's wrong? Well, that was the power of Bayes' theorem. But it sat more or less dormant for 200 years. The reason it did was that the computers were not around. And around 1980, it was discovered how to implement and use sampling methods to make Bayes' theorem a practical tool. So the Metropolis-Hastings algorithm, Markov chain Monte Carlo algorithms, and various others brought Bayes' theorem to life. And it's a very interesting, I'm going to show you in the next slide or so, how it brings together all of the uncertainties in scientific prediction. Now, there have been a lot of developments since then. Joe Halpern said he found a counterexample to Cox's theorem, and then he changed it. And then Kevin Van Horn refuted the proof of Halpern, and then there's been many, many papers back and forth. If you want to read an excellent paper on Cox's theorem, read the one by Van Horn in Journal of Approximation Theory. Journal of Approximate Reasoning, 2003. And then other papers, the famous book by Jaynes, Probability Theory, The Logic of Science, other papers on Bayes' theorem, the theorem that would not die. And then more recent papers saying Bayes' theorem doesn't work, it's brittle. Why no Bayesian method is good enough, paper by Udwadi and others. And then finally, a remarkable series of papers by Klein and Vandermark, beginning in 2006, really showing resolving old problems about asymptotic behavior of Bayesian methods. See, Bayesian methods are supposed to be learning methods. The more data you have, the more accurate the parameters in a model. And if they don't learn, something's wrong. And generally, if you have an infinite amount of data and an infinite number of parameters and the model is wrong from the beginning, can it still learn? Let me repeat that. If the model's wrong and you have infinite number of data and an infinite number of parameters, does Bayesian methods still work? Remarkable answer is yes. And I'll explain that why in a minute. Okay, let's look now at applications. I call this a canonical problem in predictive science. It's the original problem of reduced modeling. You have a bunch of atoms. You've got too many atoms to model their motion. So you lump the atoms into molecules, and you trace the motion of the molecules. And this has been going on since 1940. It really got into full swing in the 90s as computer technology grew. So this is the foundation of modern chemistry, molecular dynamics, Monte Carlo methods, and so forth. One application I've been dealing with is nanomanufacturing. You're hammering out semiconductors. These little semiconductors are about, well, the example I'm going to show, they're 70 nanometers. Now they're doing 11 nanometers. You can't see them. You need a scanning microscope to see these little things. The idea being that the more semiconductors you can get on a chip, the faster the computer. So if you take just an innocent-looking little flange in this manufacturing process, and you pick a little cube with 30 nanometers at 600 atoms on one side, you get 216 million atoms in a cube. Each atom has 3 degrees of freedom, and you want to trace their motion over 100,000 time steps. Forget it. You're not going to do it.
you're going to coarse grain the model. You're going to lump them together and reduce it to a reduced model you can solve. But the question is, what have you really done? You've changed the model. You've introduced perhaps a very large error. And are you going to make a prediction with this model? Okay, we'll see. So here's a cartoon of that. You got a bunch of atoms here. Generally, the characterization of an atomic system is known pretty accurately through X-ray crystallography, quantum mechanics. We know fairly accurately the mass of an atom. We know the bond strength. We know their location in an equilibrium configuration. Now we're going to map these into a set of beads or molecules or superatoms. And we're going to trace the motion of these guys using typical molecular dynamics models, which basically says you have a Hamiltonian. It has a kinetic energy. It has an internal energy. And you use Hamilton's equations. And for the momentum is just mass times velocity. So that's Newton's laws. And you integrate Newton's laws. And then you take ensemble averages of the result, and that gives you macroscopic properties of systems. So here's a typical internal energy function. By the way, there are many of these. This is just one example. It has harmonic bonds, harmonic angles, torsion, those are the dihedrals. It has Coulomb forces, and it has non-local forces according to the Leonard Jones potential. So you got a lot of parameters. If you pick a material and you have all of these bonds, so you have these two or maybe three or four molecules. When they move relative to one another, there's resistance, there's a harmonic spring, or if you have three of them, there's an angle, or there can be four of them if you have torsion. And then if you have these non-local effects, like the hydrogen atoms or so forth, these are non-local. And then if you have electric charges in the system, you have Coulomb effects. All of these parameters are unknown. You may know them fairly accurately for the atomistic model, but you do not know them for the coarse grain model. So this is a bewildering situation in which we find ourselves. We know we're going to have to coarse grain, but we don't know how. We use intuition sometimes, chemical intuition. We've done it 1,000 times, and we think this might be the way to do it. So you take one set of atoms, and there are many, many, many different ways to lump the atoms together. For each method that you choose, you have a different model, and the model has different parameters. So we have a whole set of models. Those are actually model classes. And each one of those classes corresponds to a different map. And for each one of those maps, for each one of those, you have many different models. What do I mean by that? I mean there are many different ways you can put in these potentials, these, let's say, covalent bond potentials, angle potentials, dihedral potentials, and so forth. Each one has a different parameter. So we have a huge number, hundreds of thousands of possible models. Each model has many model classes, and each class is an infinite class, and we don't know what to do with it. So where do we stand? Well, in the most abstract sense, you have the universe of physical realities, and we have some point in the universe, and we want to know what a physical entity is at that point. So we have an asteroid circling Jupiter, has a mountain on it. We want to know what the temperature is at the top of the mountain. That's a physical entity we want to know. Okay. And so we have some instrument. Instrument is a satellite circling the asteroid, taking reading data of some kind. And with that instrument, we acquire, we tabulate, and these are random because each time we circle, we get a different answer. We get random data, and the data has errors. I'm going to assume for simplicity that the observational error is additive. The particular subdomain of the universe that I'm looking at, I'll call it the scenario. And under that scenario, you have reality, you have the measurements, and you have the error. It has nothing to do with the model. It has nothing to do with the parameters. It has to do with how you observe nature. Remember, observation was one way of acquiring knowledge. Other way to acquire knowledge is with a model. So we make a mathematical model. This is a bunch of, in this case, ordinary differential equations. Could be partial differential equations. We have the scenario, that's the domain of the model, including initial and boundary conditions. We have a set of parameters, they're unknown. And we hope the model has a solution. We solve this solution, we get the solution, and we use the solution to estimate that reality. And of course, it's wrong. There's a reality, that's what we estimate. That's the modeling error. So we have two errors. Well, we have, I haven't talked about solving the model. We get another error when we solve the model because it's wrong. So how do we use this information to accomplish, to solve this impossible problem? Well, I go back to my friend, E.T. James. He was a character. He died in 1998. His book was published in 2003. He's a physicist. He was from the Midwest. He got an A.B. in physics from small Midwestern university and then got drafted into the Army. Spent World War II in the Pacific, and when he came out, he had the GI Bill, so he got a PhD in physics at Stanford. Well, no, he went to Stanford, and he started working with Robert Oppenheimer. Oppenheimer went to Princeton, carried with him four students. James was one. And when he got to Princeton, he said, I want you to work on quantum mechanics. He said, I don't believe in quantum mechanics. I want you to work with me, I'll teach you quantum mechanics. He says, no, you're not going to teach me quantum mechanics. You're always traveling and you're away and you want me to work your problem, I want to work my problem. So he quit Oppenheimer, went to work for Wiener. He was only one of four of Wiener's students, but that got him into probability theory and statistics. And he spent his life working on this, and he was a great proponent of the logical theory of probability as advanced by Cox, Jeffries, and others. And he said the essence of honesty and objectivity demands that we take into account all of the evidence we have and not just some arbitrarily chosen subset of it. So let's go back to Bayes' theorem. There it is up there. What we want now is to look at the absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure probability distributions for which there is a probability density function. And so we start with a prior probability density on the parameters. And then we have the likelihood. I'm going to tell you exactly what the likelihood is. It's a conditional probability on the data given the parameters. The denominator is called the evidence. The denominator is really a normalization factor. And the posterior, that's the left-hand side, is the conditional probability on the parameters given the data. An interesting thing is you start out with your prior information knowing nothing about the model, knowing nothing about the data, and you plug it in here and you come up with a new set of characterization of the parameters. Now, these are just functions. So this is a product of functions, and you generally determine these. If this is a random variable, you determine these by sampling. So the sampling algorithms, you come in and you sample. You take a Monte Carlo distribution of the parameters, and you determine the values of these products, and that gives you the distribution of the posterior. So remember that the total error was the modeling error and the observational error. If you have any probability density function for the sum, then simple arithmetic says that that's the observation and the prediction. And if you look at that as a conditional probability, given theta, what is the probability of the observation? That's the likelihood. That's what the likelihood is. What happened to reality? What happened to reality? It's nowhere. We lost reality. Wait a minute. This is science. The purpose of science is to predict reality. We lost it. Hate to tell you this, you can't. Reality is an elusive thing we spent our lifetimes for the 1,000 years to try to learn. We get more information on it, but we can never get there because there's error in observations, and there's error in the model, and there's error in the mathematics. So, contrary to common belief, science is not an objective enterprise. Science is a subjective enterprise, corrupted by errors in many aspects. So, to implement this method, we use what I call the prediction pyramid. The idea is that we have a sequence of scenarios. Scenarios, remember, the domain of the model. We start with some simple component pieces. Those will be our calibration scenarios, and we have calibration data. Remember what calibration was? Calibration is where you tune the parameters of a model to agree with experiments. So you can calibrate a model. It means that you've made it agree with experiments, but it doesn't mean it's the right model. And now you increase the sophistication of these models going up the pyramid. You get to the validation scenarios. Now you have new subsystem data. And finally, when you're confident enough that the parameters and the predictions agree, then you leap into outer space. You make an extrapolation to an event that you not only have never seen before, but you never will see. You make a prediction of event that is not observable. And we do it all the time. Engineers do it all the time. For example, when you design a building, you design a building to function under design loads, but the building doesn't even exist yet. So you make a prediction of how events will happen in the future. So you start with a prior. You use Bayes' theorem to update the parameters. Now you take the posterior. It becomes a prior for the validation test. Finally, when you're satisfied that you know with sufficient accuracy the parameters, you put the parameters in the model, and you solve the forward problem with the stochastic parameters. You solve it Monte Carlo method or polynomial chaos or whatever. And when you're done, you get an answer, and the answer is the quantity of interest. It is itself a probability distribution, conditioned on the parameters and the various scenarios. For example, going back to my nanomanufacturing thing, if you pick a volume of molecules, and you say, I want for that volume, I want to know its total potential energy, or I want to know its Helmholtz free energy, or I want to know its mechanical properties. You can find in here a bunch of building blocks. I call them polynomial chains, or representative polynomial chains. And the polynomial chains themselves can be broken into building blocks. So I'm going to perform experiments with these building blocks. I'm going to call them my calibration experiments. I'm going to get a good first guess at all the parameters. Then I'm going to look at more complicated units as I move up the pyramid. And finally, I will reach one. I can go no further. I can go no further because my budget is expired. It's too big. It's the maximum complexity I can handle. And to determine if that model, which I have confidence in, if it agrees with experiment sufficiently, then I'll accept it and I'll make a prediction. Now, if you unravel the sentence I just said, you'll see there's a problem with it. I said, I determine a validation scenario. I determine a validation test. Well, that's a very subjective thing. Are there any rules I can use to determine if a validation test is sufficient? Answer is yes, I'll tell you in a second. Another thing I said that leads some people to worry is I said you must determine if the accuracy of the prediction is adequate. Well, that's a very subjective thing. It may be adequate to you and not to me. So you have to pick a metric to measure the accuracy of a prediction, and you have to determine a tolerance that you will accept as a sufficiently adequate prediction. Well, now, wait a minute. I've left the realm of numbers and functions. I'm now in the realm of probability measures and densities. So I'm going to have to find a way to compare probabilities, and I'm going to have to find a way to introduce a metric. Let's start with a likelihood. R.A. Fisher, who is a frequentist statistician, said, hold your breath, and if you understand this, raise your hand. The likelihood that any parameter should have any assigned value is proportional to the probability that this were true, the totality of all observations should be that observed. Do you understand that? You have to read it 3 or 4 times before you understand it. What he's really saying is that the likelihood is if you give me a parameter, for a fixed parameter, the probability that you will see that observation is the likelihood. And it's the probability of the difference between the observation and the model. If the events are independent and identically distributed, the likelihood is a product of likelihoods for each observation. And if you have a sum of probabilities, most people like to take the logarithm of both sides because the maximum of the sum is the same as the maximum of the logarithm. So people like to work with the log likelihood. And frequentist statistics is mainly concerned with finding the maximum likelihood. That's what Mr. Laplace worked on, 1773 onward, until Mr. Price went and said, wait a minute, you forgot the priors. Then he started using Bayesian methods. If you take the parameter that gives you the maximum likelihood, that's called the MLE, and if G of Y is the true probability density of the quantity of interest, then a simple little algebraic thing will show you that the maximum prior minimizes this thing called the Kullback-Leibler divergence. It's the integral of G log G over pi. That's the way you compare probability distributions. It comes about naturally. You want a property of the maximum likelihood. It's the likelihood that minimizes the distance from your model to the truth. It's not symmetric. It's not a true metric. The people use it as a metric. It's a pseudometric. It's hard to escape it. It pops up all the time in statistics. As a natural way to compare two probability distributions. The prior, how do we know the prior? The prior for absolute ignorance, if you don't know anything about the parameters, is you just take an interval. You take the uniform prior. It's between minus 100 and plus 100. That's a very bad thing to do. If you know anything about the prior, the whole process can be greatly accelerated. Well, there's another famous theorem laid down by Claude Shannon in 1948. Shannon invented information theory. By the way, the proof of Shannon's theory is very much like the proof of Cox's theorem. It's unbelievable that the human mind could figure out how to do that. It's not your standard mathematical proof. It's very, very tricky. He said, I want something to measure, the best way to measure the uncertainty content in a probability distribution. I'm going to call it H. It's a real number. It's continuous. Then he says it's common sense. Common sense meant, well, common sense to Shannon meant something slightly different. It meant it was a monotonic function of n if it was a frequency accessed 1 over n times. And it also obeyed the principles of deductive logic and had the consistency, meaning two different approaches had to lead to the same thing. He derived it, and by the way, his consultant at Bell Labs at the time was none other than a guy named John von Neumann. And he says, what does this look like? Here's the measure. John von Neumann says, it looks like entropy to me. So they called it the entropy. And it is indeed almost verbatim the same as the entropy of statistical mechanics. So the entropy of a probability is minus the sum of pi log pi. Moreover, he showed that if you have many different choices of a probability, the one that maximizes the entropy is the right one. So the only function satisfying those logical desiderata, the information entropy, and it maximizes P subject to constraints. Well, that's a great tool. E.T. James, he says, ha, that's a way I can determine priors. If I take my parameters in a model and I know anything about them, the mean or the variance, I know that they must maximize the entropy. By the way, entropy has nothing to do with Bayes' theorem. It's beyond Bayes' theorem. It has to do with parameters and information. So, by the way, there it comes again, the Kullback-Leibler divergence. If you have two PDFs, the Kullback-Leibler divergence is integral of P log P over Q. And if you spread that out, you get the entropy of P minus 1 times what is called the relative entropy or the cross entropy of P and Q. So if you suppose you knew the mean of the parameters, you knew the mean, then you can set up a constrained maximization problem, and you can determine the prior. If you only know the mean, the prior has to be an exponential distribution. If you know the variance, it's a Gaussian distribution. So it is possible, and I have a couple of students who've become experts at this. It's possible to give you a bunch of data and to sort it around and use Shannon's theorem to get very good approximations of the mean, of the prior. By the way, what if you're wrong? What if your prior is wrong? That's automatically built into the Bayesian method. If your prior is wrong, as you get more data, it corrects itself. That's called the Bayesian, well, under certain conditions. So it's a better approximation for the prior. So remember, I'm looking at Bayes' theorem. I have the prior, I have the likelihood, and I have the denominator. The denominator is called the evidence, and most people say, oh, throw the evidence away. It's just a normalization factor. But no. The evidence turns out to be one of the most important properties of Bayes' theorem. If you go back to Bayes' theorem and you recognize that I have more prior information, I not only know I have data, but I know that this model came from a set of models. So I know that I not only have that data, but I have a model from a set of models. Remember Mr. James said, the essence of honesty and ethics is to use all the information you have and not an arbitrarily chosen subset of it. Here we are. We're going to use all the information we have. So we recognize that we're conditioned on the choice of the model.
we rewrite Bayes' theorem, we take the marginalization of the numerator, and we get what is called the model evidence. Then we realize we've reduced the problem to a discrete problem of M models. And now we use Bayes' theorem once again on the M models, and we get is what is called the model plausibility. It's amazing. I didn't know about this a few years ago, and when I first saw this, I didn't believe it. Now I'm an evangelist. I preach it. The model plausibility tells you of a set of models which one is most plausible given data. You know, if you were an engineer taking a course in engineering, you were told that the model is selected by the expert based on judgment and experience. Baloney. The model can be determined using Bayesian plausibilities. If you know the model and you know the data, you can ask the question of all these models, which one best fits the data? The sum is 1, and the model closest to 1, is not unique, there may be many that have the same plausibility. The one closest to 1 is the best. Now, any of these problems, you soon find out that you have an impossible number of parameters. If you take that polymer that I was showing for nanomanufacturing, you have 148, 160 parameters, maybe more. But soon you realize that not all the parameters affect the answer. So as an intermediate step, I'm only going to accept those parameters which prove to influence my observation. And for that purpose, I use sensitivity analysis, and there's a growing literature on sensitivity analysis. Saltelli has written 2 books on it. Sobel has several famous papers. The idea is that you pick a function, call the output, you compute its variance, you take one parameter in the model and you hold it fixed and you vary everything else, that gives you this guy. You take the ratio and that gives you a measure of variance-based sensitivity. So let's see if it works. By the way, the total effective sensitivity is 1 minus the variance. So if you take an example, a polyethylene chain with 24 beads, and you take the total potential energy as an output function, and you use a Monte Carlo variation of all the parameters, and you find what the total output is, you find that of those 10 parameters, 4 of them didn't affect the answer at all. So you throw them away. So you went from 10 parameters to 6 parameters. Now, you're sort of worried, did that really work? Well, you better calculate the problem with and without them to see if it works. So here's the answer with the dihedrals, and there's the answer. The answer means the total kernel density function as a function of changes in potential energy. This is the probability distributions, and they're virtually the same. So indeed, the idea of sensitivity is a very effective idea, and it's being used a lot. It was surprising how long this idea took to get in the literature, but now you're beginning to see it in these big problems. Okay, let's put everything together and see what we have. Everybody heard of Occam's razor? He's another preacher. He was a a friar in 13th century England. He was kind of a mathematician. He was at Cambridge for a while. And he wrote this famous principle, quote principle. In simplistic terms, it says, always use the simplest model necessary. The exact statement of Occam's principle was in Latin, si non
mathematiques sont nécessaires, or something like that. Do not multiply entities unnecessarily. Use the simplest possible. Of course, everyone has been fighting for 100 years, I mean, a millennia almost. How many? 900 years. It's what does simple mean? So if you look up books on philosophy of science, you will find that few people accept Occam's principle as a true scientific principle because of this fallacy, this problem. However, you're perfectly free to define what you mean by simplicity. If you accept the definition of simplicity, then it becomes a principle in which you can proceed. So we will choose, we will say the measure of simplicity will be the number of parameters in a model. And generally, that's more or less true. Because if you, the bigger the number of parameters, the longer it takes to solve one of these models. And when I say solve one of these models, I'm talking about 2,500 to 3,000 processors a week to solve one of these problems. 24 hours a day. These are big problems. You have to use parallel computers. So here's our target problem. We're going to take a box of polyethylene, and I want to know some property of it. Let's say I want to know its total potential energy. So that's the prediction scenario. On the right-hand side is the coarse grain model. Here's a smaller box. That's its coarse grain model. Here's a subset of two chains out of this one. That's its coarse grain model. And here's just a single chain. And that's its coarse grain model. This is going to be my calibration, validation number one, validation number two, and prediction. So I call this the OPL algorithm, O-P-L-L, the Occam plausibility algorithm. You start with a set of models. You do a sensitivity analysis. You eliminate all those that you think do not impact the quantity of interest. Is there a danger of doing this? Yeah, there is a little danger, but I'm going to catch it. Even if that's wrong, I will catch it in this problem. Then you partition the surviving models into categories according to their number of parameters. I call those the Occam categories. You pick the models with the smallest category, smallest number of parameters, and you determine among those which is the most plausible. Remember, the plausibility is the marginalization of the likelihood and the prior, taking into account that you have m different models for fixed data. How do I choose the model? Well, the top one is the true hydrogen carbon bead. Here's a corruption where I have three carbons per bead. I'm throwing away all the hydrogen. Two and then one, that's called a unit atom. I'm going to start with this one, where I have two atoms per bead. I look at all the possible models, 15 models, classifying 15 models. This one has bonds, angles, dihedrals, Leonard Jones. So I'm going to do a sensitivity analysis. And here is a sensitivity analysis starting with the prediction scenario. Here, this is prediction. That's the big block. Then I move to validation scenario one, validation scenario two, calibration. And guess what? Every single one of them, the dihedrals did not influence my quantity of interest. So I'm going to throw them away. Now remember, about 30 minutes ago, I said I would also tell you how to choose the validation scenario. One way is to never pick a validation scenario that has different sensitivities than the quantity of interest. So you will be using parameters that don't work at all, don't influence the parameters. So you breathe a sigh of relief when you see that the validation scenarios also share the opinion that these parameters did not influence the answer. There's one other way to compute the validation, and I'll tell you that in a minute. So we partition these, we come down, all of those with dihedrals we throw away. That leaves us now only these models. We break them into models with two parameters, four parameters, and six parameters, and we start with the lowest number of parameters. That's Occam's simplest model. We now do the, we look at the model with the fewest parameters. We do the plausibility. This is a big calculation. It uses a code called queso, which is multi-level Markov chain Monte Carlo methods, and it samples these guys and gives you the plausibility. We find out that in this particular case, there's only one model that's plausible. The others are not exactly zero. They may be 10 to the 40th, minus 40. We look at that model and we go. We do the validation step. We compute the posterior. And with the posterior, we compute the quantity of interest. So let pi of q, that's the quantity of interest, denote the probability distribution for the answer. That's the all-atom model. Let pi of q, conditioned on our best guess at the parameters, be the estimate. And let's set a tolerance. We set a tolerance at 15% of the variance. Or another tolerance, we could set it 1% of the total quantity of interest. The first one is if we're comparing distributions. The second is if we're comparing real numbers. Those are metrics. And we find that they both work. The prediction is quite good. We declare the model not invalid. I'd like to say it's valid, but I'm very careful because I know if additional data came along, if you changed anything, it might not be valid. But I'll accept it. So let's cheat. Ordinarily, you can never compute the quantity of interest. I said it's something in the future, but I'm going to compute it anyway just to see how good my answer was, and it's pretty darn good. Notice the scale here. The origin is way over here. So that's the predicted, and that's the real, and it's only about 3% difference in terms of means. But now let's change the tolerance. Then the model becomes invalid. So now we go back through this process. We now go to the four-parameter models. We compute their plausibility. Only one was plausible. We compute its validation, and it's valid. So understand that when you stop this process, there may be models out there that are better models. You don't care. All you want is one that's valid, and you'll stop there. You don't want the best model. It's almost impossible to get the best model. It's just like when you refine a mesh. When you reach an error tolerance, you stop. You don't keep refining it. Okay. That's basically the heart of the talk. I think I'm about done. I have some quick things I'll run through. We laid a groundwork to solve the basic problems of predictive science for a very complex model. We have an algorithm that will eventually, a very expensive algorithm, we need to make it run faster, an algorithm that will eventually pick a model that works, and it will also solve the problem of model inadequacy, the wrong model. It will get a model that works within a tolerance. But that's the nature of all science. Everyone has built in, either consciousness or subconsciousness, a tolerance they will accept. The answers are not numbers, the answers are probability densities. We've taken into account uncertainty in the data, uncertainty in the model, uncertainty in the parameters, uncertainty in the answers, and we've quantified that uncertainty. That was the goal. Very quickly, I will rush through some other things that you might be interested in. I just wrote down some theorems. This is the classical Bernstein-von Mises theorem. It's an old theorem that's got a lot of attention recently. That's the Bayesian central limit theorem. If you keep getting more data, will it work? And the answer is yes. It will converge in the TV norm to a Gaussian centered at the maximum likelihood with a covariance equal to what is called the Fisher information, inverse of the Fisher information matrix, provided the likelihood is twice differentiable. On the other hand, if you have a misspecified model, meaning that the parameter does not belong to the parameter space, I mean that the truth, there's no parameter that will give you the truth, it belongs to the support of the prior, then it's a much, much, much more complicated issue. And there's an excellent theorem due to Klein and van der Waart that gives two sufficient conditions for this to work. I see Salim putting on his coat back there. I'm almost through. Let me just say that I can prove that if model one is more plausible than model two, then its DKL distance to the truth is closer. Under stronger conditions, the opposite holds. If the DKL distance from the model to the truth is closer, then model one is more plausible than model two. I have some other results on a posterior error estimation, but I will think I will forego those. If you want to see them during the coffee break, I'll be happy to discuss them with you. One final comment. The actual science of logic is conversant at present only with things either certain, impossible, or entirely doubtful, none of which, fortunately, we have to reason on. Therefore, the true logic of this world is the calculus of probabilities, which takes into account the magnitude of the probability, which is, or ought to be, in a reasonable man's mind. Clerk Maxwell said that in 1850. Thank you for your kind attention. Forgot to acknowledge my students and my support by the Department of Energy, Catherine Farrell, who just defended her dissertation this week, and Daniel Fagai, he's a postdoc. And then I thank you very much.
Do we have time for questions?
Yes, sir.
Back in the 60s, the psychologists had a method called limited information maximum likelihood. It wasn't as sophisticated as your method, but do you know anything about it? Limited information maximum
likelihood. I can guess. I don't know anything about it, but I can guess what it was. Shannon's information theory is an extremely powerful idea. It goes beyond just introducing entropy. It introduces a measure of information. See, Shannon, you had a signal coming, an electrical signal. He wanted to truncate the signal and find out how much information he lost. So he invented information theory. Now, there's something called the mutual information you can compute. It looks very much like the DKL. And it will tell you, as I move from one bit of information to another, did I gain information? And usually it's the ratio of the likelihood to the prior. No, it's the posterior to the prior. So you start with the prior, you have a likelihood, you compute new information. Did I gain anything? Well, you compute the DKL distance between the posterior and the prior, and that's an answer. That's a measure of information gain. I have a hunch from the words you use that's something like that. So, and information gain, by the way, is the other thing I was going to mention. If you're going to design a validation experiment, you start with a prior. That's the best knowledge you have. Design the experiment so that your information gain is high as possible. If it's not, the experiment's no good. Now, that's an easy thing to say, difficult to do. Because it's an optimization problem in which the design of the experiment must be presented in terms of a new set of parameters, not the model parameters, but the experimental parameters,
You must choose those parameters that your information is the maximum possible. And that's the way to design experiments. That's the only information I can give you on that. That's the only thing I can think of.
Sir, you mentioned a little bit about a number magic. And, you know, in theory, Bayesian methods, they treat parameters as random variable.
Yeah.
Okay, right. So number magic means distribution free. You don't know the distribution, so there is no parameter. So, you know, you mentioned a little bit, I'm just curious how you will, you know, use your...
This is solely based on parametric models.
Okay.
Everything here is parametric model.
Okay.
You have.
Okay.
Navier-Stokes equations, elasticity, contact problems, models, they all have parameters.
Okay. So non-parametric, you know, because I
saw
you.
The word non-parametric is different.
Yeah.
Non-parametric does not mean no parameters.
Okay.
Non-parametric means infinite parameters.
Okay.
Just the opposite. And that, the infinite parameter case is quite difficult. Because you're looking at the limit of these sequences of estimates. And that last paper I mentioned by Klein and Van der Barton, that's for the infinite parameter case. If you do not pick the prior correctly, it doesn't work. So you have two sufficient conditions that you must pick that the prior must satisfy so that the prior must focus sufficient mass, probability mass, on the answer. On the truth that it will converge. So, but yeah, the non-parametric problems represent a classically difficult mathematical problem.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Other questions?
Is it implicit when you have a mathematical model to limit it to the existing mathematical knowledge? In other words, when you set up a model, that has some mathematical expression there, right? And is it implicit in the modeling that we restrict it to the existing mathematical knowledge?
Excellent question, excellent question. Answers yes and no. Let me give you an example. We're working on models of the growth of tumors. Extraordinarily complex problem. You have the tumor mass, you have the mass of dead cells, necrotic cells, you have extracellular matrix, you have the bicellular base, you have drugs being added, you have hundreds of species. How do you develop a model? Well, the first thing you do is you fall back on time-proven models. You don't want to produce a model that doesn't conserve mass. You don't want to produce a model that doesn't conserve energy or momentum. Beyond that, there is always an embedded model that you don't know. And that's where it comes to physical experience, intuition. These are generally the constitutive equations, for example, in continuum mechanics. That's where the big error is. And so, answer is yes. You fall back on time-proven principles, but they do not completely determine the model. There are other parts of the model that are invariably out of reach and must be fashioned with experiments.
Thank you.
Yeah.
We have time for maybe one or two questions.
You've been kind. Thank you so much.
Thank you.